Original gun claps. Make your ass run, guys. One time. Oh, y'all can kiss, but the sun don't shine. I want mine. He's stepping in hot to this year.
The rain coming like a hurricane with no fear. Cause in the streets we ain't got no peace. Shoot the beast from the east, but you run from police. Don't try me, cause I be the bomb like Bozzy. Straight from OGC, yeah, heat shit up like Hawaii. Five when I'm live like a four-wheel drive. Every day I start to make y'all rappers realize how dangerous. Strangle gets on the mica. Phone with Louisville zones, it gets me hyper. The type to snipe your ass from up close. This is the boot camp show. I'm your host, Starang Wonder. No relation to Stevie. And no, I'm not West Indian or Haitian. But I'm on probation for knocking whack MCs out daily. Plus, I fly heads like comments from Alex Haley. Now tell me, won't this fucking verse right here turn a whack rapper's day into his worst nightmare? I scare petty MCs who claim they got gats. Frontin' with hoes and videos with pimp hats. But the fact still remains that you're just a stain on the bottom of my boots while I'm still Starang BCC. From 99 past 2000, make your heads in the crowd out there wonder how we be still
stepping in hotter this year.
Welcome to the show. It's Encyclopedia Hip Hop. It's the podcast. I'm Eclectic, but you know that by now. My guest, you know, is no longer a guest. When he's here, he's the co-host. You know, when I'm not flying solo, he's the co-host. He has his own podcast. He has other podcasts, Dead End Sports stuff. I don't listen to it. you know, but he does a lot of things. He's been on the show more times than you can count. Dwarf Cow, you know your pods are kicking. Get on the mic because you know you eat chicken.
What up? What's going on, people? As always, man, it's good to be back in the building with my man, Eclectic. E, what's going on, man?
Yeah, listen, I crack open the mics, man. So a lot of podcasting has been going on my airwaves and your airwaves lately.
It's true.
And,
this is true.
And getting a lot of good feedback from the people. And when I get that kind of feedback, it makes me want to do more shows.
Oh, no question. And I think one of the reasons, and same with me, I've been getting a lot of great feedback, particularly for the podcast that we've done. And I think one of the things that I enjoy about it is that there's a generation of people who come from, maybe they weren't around in the 80s or 90s and some of the things that we've talked about. And so it's really like schooling them. And then for those who lived through that era, you know, they're hip to it and they understand it. So they have an even better appreciation to have two cats on the mic talking about it.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, just the mere fact of putting numerous people on the Granddaddy IU. I told people he was slept on underrated. Next to, you know, people like, yo, this dude is dope as hell. I'm like, I'm trying to tell people.
You did,
man.
This you did.
I'm trying
you did.
To tell people. Look, we can wax poetic later. One day we're just going to do a show where it's no format, it's no topic, and we're just going to get on here and just talk hip-hop and just yes, talk sir. Shit. It's going to be a good show. But today, what we're going to do, we're going to have another one of our air quote epic debates. Much like the EPMD versus Tribe.
Which was rigged.
It was not rigged. It was solid.
But for those of you who heard the podcast, geez, he tried to get the Russians involved, but it didn't work.
It didn't. I didn't need them, and it did work. But if you haven't heard that one, you know, get familiar, go click it. But this episode, as you could tell by the title, because you had to click this one, 1995 versus 1996. Which was the best year in hip-hop? Look, we all know the 1988 was the end-all be-all for hip-hop. Facts. That's number one.
Facts.
That's number one. We're not disputing it. If you want to come on... All right, you're not coming on. If you want to get on Twitter, if you want to get on Kyle's Facebook, if you want to get on Black Planet, I don't know, and debate that 1988 isn't the greatest year in hip-hop, by all means, you'll be wrong. And especially if you say anything that begins with 2000.
Right.
But that's not that. That's another time. You know, if you want to send us an email, we'll read the email on air and you know, discuss it. But 1995 versus 1996, which is the best year in hip hop? I am going to take the position of 1995.
And I am going to take the position of 1996 because by far,
oh, Jesus,
1996 was the better year in hip hop.
And so what we're going to have to do, no, what he is going to have to do is prove this because you know. So a couple of things that we're going to discuss. We're going to discuss albums.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to discuss singles.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's just maybe it's just a little back and forth where we try to state our case. Now, since you're the co-host, how would you like to tackle this? I'm going to give you the floor. Again, I'm magnanimous. I'm going to give you the floor. I'm going to let you guide how this goes so that you can be proven wrong.
You know what, man? I think, and I appreciate you for giving me the floor because I should have the floor because I'm always right.
Mm-hmm.
Nonetheless, I think we should start with the albums first because 95 had a great run of albums. 96 had a great run of albums.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, subsequently the years after that, hip hop really fell off.
Well, yes, I'm going to agree. Okay, so I'm gonna assume that you prepared a list of your favorite or what you consider to be the greater hip hop albums of 1990. What are you doing? 1996? Is that what you're doing?
1996. This is true.
All right. So let's do this. Do you have them in order? Are you a good guy? Do you know? Are you
I most certainly do.
All right.
And you know, come on, man. No, prepare, no. Never scared. I'll just bless one.
Okay, so let's do this. How many do you have in your list?
I got 10. And I also have some honorable mentions because, you know, I never know how you come on this podcast.
Listen, so, hey, man, whatever you want to do, man. Okay, so let's do it like this. Give me your bottom five. Give me 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. What do you got?
Okay. Let's start off at number 10. Number 10 album from 1990. And this is just my personal ranking.
Mm-hmm.
96, as I mentioned, and if you've heard the 12 Kyle podcast, you know that 96 was an incredible year for hip hop.
Mm.
But number 10, man, I'm coming in at number 10, and this was a toss up, man. But number 10, I got Il Nana, Foxy Brown.
Ooh. Now, listen, I can't really argue with that. In my opinion, and I stated this on Twitter, the Il Nana by Foxy Brown is the most complete hip hop album by a female hip hop soloist. That is my position. Any hip hop album done by a female MC pales in comparison to the Il Nana. It is the most complete album. The songs, the subject matter is dynamic. It's not like versus like hardcore where every song is about eating somebody's pussy.
Yeah, hardcore was something else. Another 96 gem.
It's not like messy stuff where you don't even know what she's talking about half the time.
Stop. There will be no Missy slander on this podcast.
It's not like a lot of the other ones where it's all one note. You know, the Il Nana had the party joints. It had the introspective joints, the F.I. And it had straight hip-hop joints. It had
radio joints.
Radio joints. I mean, and it all flowed together. The production's crazy. Now, I say all that to say, personally, love it to death.
Mm-hmm.
But on, say, the Twitter universe, they dog it a lot. A lot of people don't like Il Nana.
Because they're low bottom haters, man.
I'm just throwing it out there. What I'm saying is if we put this up in some sort of poll versus something else, unfortunately, not any of my doing, Il Nana would lose. But anyway, I'm going to go with my 10.
Okay.
My number 10. My number 10, obviously, came out in 1995.
Right.
It is a solo effort by Mr. Knowledge Reigns Supreme over nearly everyone.
Okay.
KRS-One album, self-titled, included MCs Act Like They Don't Know,
mm-hmm.
Rappers Are in Danger, Free My Mia.
Mm-hmm.
Slept on Aw Yeah. So I think that is a very strong 1995 effort by L. Dot Parker.
You know what? I like that. I actually love that album. KRS-One is one of the most, one of the greatest lyricists of all time. He's personally in my top five. And this was a great album, man. And I think a lot of people, you know, it kind of started to sleep on him because they thought that he was kind of falling off at that particular time. So when that album dropped in 95, man, like you said, MCs Act Like They Don't Know with Primo on the track.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very dope album, man. Very dope. And, you know, most hip hop heads have that album.
At least they should.
They should.
And shouts to Diamond D on the production, too.
Oh, for sure.
What you got at 9?
Number 9, I got a double CD. Guy who unfortunately passed away in 1996 through no fault of his own. One of the most, and here again, on this particular podcast.
Rapping Duke?
We don't care about album sales, but this album sold through the roof. I think this album went diamond, 10 million copies sold.
Okay.
That would be one Tupac, Amaru Shakur with All Eyes on Me. I think this was a very, very good album. I will say this much. I think the public acknowledges this album and loves it a lot more than I do. Mm-hmm. I love this album. The only, and I've said this on my podcast as well, the knock that I have on this album is that it's too many songs.
Well, it's a double album.
Yeah, exactly. If he'd made a single, and we've seen that in hip hop before.
Mm.
If you make a single, you're dope. If you make a double, then you have, you know, some watered down tracks and, you know, filler songs or whatever like that. That being said, still an incredible album for 1996. All Eyes on Me, Tupac Shakur. Man, I'm telling you, this is one of the staples of 1996.
I'm not going to disagree with you by saying it's one of the staples of 1996. But since 1995 is better than 1996, it doesn't really matter. I'm going to be honest with you. I think it's well known that I'm not a Tupac fan, but I will say that I did like, I think, 3 songs on the double LP release of All Eyes on Me.
3 out of 24? That's not bad.
3 out of 24, yeah. would you care to guess? One is easy.
Let me guess. The joint with the 7779311 sample.
One is easy because it has Method Man and Redman on it.
Oh, of course.
So that's easy. The other one is an incredibly dumb song, and I only halfway like it because it was played a lot when I was out and about, and that's the Ambitions song.
Oh yeah,
the song Ambitions is dumb. The song is idiotic. Yeah, the song is idiotic, but
love that joint.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. and the third one, I think, and I'm pretty sure it's on there, is the All About You.
That one got old once it got to radio for me.
See, here's the thing. Before you finish,
go ahead.
It never got old to me because I never played it. I never owned the album, so I would only hear it when I go over to somebody's playing it. That's when I hear the song. I am 90% sure I have never heard that whole song from start to finish.
I'm surprised that you never own that album.
Why would I?
But that was a dope album in 96. I thought at the very least you would have a dub or something.
Not for me. I've only owned one Tupac album in my life.
That's crazy.
And that's
Let me guess. That was gonna be my guess. Tupacalypse Now.
I love Tupacalypse Now. But
that was a dope album.
Yeah, I'm never gonna own it. But go ahead. The song got old for you?
Yeah, yeah, it got old, man. But it was because I played it on the album, and I thought it was dope when I played it on the album. But then, when it got to radio, and of course, you know, it had Nate Dogg on the hook, you know, it got a lot of spins, and it just got old to me. But I think, you know, top to bottom, as I mentioned, outside of the filler songs, this is a dope album, man. This is Tupac's best album, but it's not my favorite Tupac album. Unlike you, I have all of Tupac's albums up until the time he died.
Wow, look at you. Stop buying
the when I bought the changes. I can't remember the name of it. Remember Me. Are You Still Down? Remember Me. But after that albums, I didn't buy. But, I think that this is a staple of 1996. I think if you ask people, this album probably is going to be a lot higher than I have it at 9. I think a lot of people is going to have it relatively higher than what I have it at. But yeah, dope album.
Okay. So here's the thing. So you can call this whatever you want, but number 9, I have what the majority of the people I ever talk to say is Tupac's greatest album. And that is Me Against the World.
My favorite. My personal favorite.
It's your personal favorite. If you go to anywhere online and look for a ranking of his albums, if you go to Twitter, if you go to Facebook, everyone's going to say this is the better album. What I'm trying to illustrate early here, 95, greater than symbol, 96.
And what you folks are witnessing and listening to is the shenanigans that he's trying to pull, but we're not going for it today.
It's not shenanigans. It is.
This man doesn't even own this album, but he has it at number 9. That should tell you
This was not a list of my favorite albums.
Right. We just said the best.
And by popular opinion, this would probably be at number probably 2 on the list in 95.
I would say, yeah, All Eyes on Me would definitely be higher than 9 for me.
And since this one is better than All Eyes on Me, this one would be even higher. So all I gotta say about Me Against the World is it does have maybe my favorite Tupac song on it.
Okay.
Would you like to guess what?
Let's take a guess. I would probably say Old School.
You know, that is number 2.
Wow.
That is my number 2 Tupac song. And my first 2 are on this album. Everything else is on Tupac Lips Now, except for My Mind's Made Up. My favorite Tupac song is Temptations.
Wow, I didn't see that coming.
And the only reason is because of Eric Sermon.
Okay.
Yeah.
I feel you on that.
And then Old School, and then Soldier Story.
Mm-hmm.
I might like a solid 5 Tupac songs out of his whole
out of his whole discography.
I got a solid 5. I got a solid 5. But
that's better.
But I think the populace would agree that this album is the pinnacle of his discography.
I disagree. I think people would say that All Eyes on Me is because he just got out of jail.
Yeah, I'm sure that has a lot to do with it. So what we'll do is we'll put a poll up.
Yeah.
And then on either your podcast or mine, you can state how you were wrong and you apologize to the listeners.
Let's do it.
That's fair enough. Okay.
Let's do it.
All right. Let's go with 8.
All right, number 8, man, I got to go to Sha Lin. Man, this album is an album that I played constantly, man. You can't go wrong when you go to the Wu-Tang Clan, man. So coming in at number 8, man, I got Ghostface, Iron Man.
This must be one hell of a list if that's at 8. Okay. Hey, that's solid, man. That is very solid, man.
Of course it is.
It's an incredible album.
Incredible album.
That is probably that's probably one of the better ones that you've mentioned so far. I mean, a person I like Nana, but as far as, you know, that Iron Man, that is strong. I can't.
Daytona 500.
There's nothing to skip
Fish,
on that album.
Fish, Cam A. Come on, man.
Nothing to skip. I can't say anything more about that.
Quick question. Mm-hmm. Where do you rank this in Ghostface's discography? Your own personal.
My own personal is number one.
Okay. Wow. Okay. I toggle back and forth with this one and Bulletproof Wallets. Mm. I love Bulletproof Wallets.
Well, the answer is you toggle back and forth between this and Supreme Clientele, but okay. Sure. I mean, listen, Ghostface is is underrated not from being an MC, but underrated by having a damn near flawless discography.
Damn near. By far the best out of the Wu as far as his discography.
I mean, instead of best out of the Wu, I mean, I'm talking period. If you go album for album for having so many albums, the only couple of people that rival him is Redman is number one.
Right. But nobody else in the crew.
Oh, definitely nobody else in the crew. But, you know.
Shout out to Mobility.
Wow. Yeah. I don't even want to discuss.
We were so disappointed.
I don't want to discuss. Wu-Tang's back for more. You heard other raps before, but kept waiting for the son of song. I keep dance hall strong. Beats another worthy of my cause. I prolong extravaganza. Time sits still. No propaganda. Be wary of the skill. As I bring forth the music, make love to your eardrum. Dedicated to rap, nigga. Beware the fearsome. Lebanon, Don, Malcolm X, beat threat. CD massacre. Murder to cassette. I blow the shop up. You ain't seen nothing yet. One man ran trying to get away from it. Put your bifocal on. Watch me a cometh into your chamber like Freddy into dream. This kaboomerate your technique in your scheme. Four cause applause like a black dad did that. You stuck on stupid like I'm stuck on the map. Nowhere to go except next show, bro. Entertaining motherfuckers can't stop O.M. battling. You don't want me to start tattling. All up on the stage cause y'all snakes keep rattling. Bitch, you ain't got nothing on the rich. Every other day my whole dress code switch. So just in case you wanna clock me like Sherry. All y'all crab bitches ain't got the worry. Can't get a nigga like Don Dime a dozen. Even if I'm smoked out, I can't be scoped out. I'm too ill. I represent Park Hill. See my face on a $20 bill. Cash it in and get $10 back. The fat LP with cappuccino on the wax. Pass it in your thing, put valve up to 12. Put all the other LPs back on the shelf and smoke a blunt and dial 917 16049311. And you could get long dick hip hop affection. I damage any MC who step in my direction. I'm Staten Island best, son, fuck what you heard. Niggas still talking, that shit is absurd. My repertoire is USSR. PLO style got thrown out the car and ran over by the Method Man Jeep. Divine can't define my style, it's so deep like pussy. My low cut face stay bushy like a porcupine. I part backs like a spine. Cut you like a blunt and reconstruct your design. I know you wanna diss me, but I could read your mind. Cause you're weak in the knees like SWV. Trying to get a title like Wu Killer B. Kid, change your habit. You know I'm friends with the Abbott. Me and RZA Rod name printed in the tablet under vets. We paid our debts for mad years. Hibernated sound and now we out like bears. Inborn power, born physically, power speaking. The truth in the song be the pro-black teaching. Look, number 8 I have on my list.
Okay.
The GOAT. Ladies and gentlemen, number 8 on the list. Mr. Smith. A criminally underrated album. People sleep on this album. I don't know why, but they sleep.
I'll give my theory in a second. Go ahead.
It had a lot of choice. It had Lounging.
Mm-hmm.
It had Hey Lover.
Mm-hmm.
I had Doing It. I mean, these are platinum singles. But then he gave you the I Shot Ya original with Keith Murray on the hook. You want a hit, give me your album plus a pen and a pad. Then he gave you the I Shot Ya remix where Foxy Brown just went bananas. Then if you listen to this podcast, you know the song Hip Hop is dear to my heart, just also on there. Also, the song Make It Hot. The song Make It Hot is crazy. The song has, the album has like 15 tracks. It probably has 10 super dope ones. And so, I had to put it on the list. I don't think anybody with a non-biased ear could listen to the songs that I mentioned and say it's not one of the craziest, dopest albums yet.
This album is, as I mentioned, probably the last very good to great album LL's made.
I'm gonna disagree because Phenomenon was dope.
No, Phenomenon was okay. But to answer your point as far as why it, you know, why the album didn't take off or the way it should have been, was just what you mentioned. Those three radio, and it's not LL's fault, but those three radio singles overshadowed the rest of this album. And you and I had, we had debated on, I think, a, you know, previous podcast about LL and LL's discography. And you know what? I was messing around one day at work. I said, you know what, man, I'm gonna go back and listen to Mr. Smith album. And I went back and listened to it. And I was like, yo. And it just kind of like, it was interesting because I have the CD, but I hadn't heard it in a while. And I went back and listened. I was like, yo, this okay, I remember this. And I'm like, okay, I remember this. Oh, this was on here. I was constantly saying that as I'm listening to the album. Then I get to the hip hop joint. Of course, I remember that from this podcast. But, you know, hearing the whole song in its totality and where the song is sequenced, I'm like, yo, this is a very good album. But that's what happened. Radio caught wind of this album and those singles took off and everybody forgot about the album. So they were just interested in the singles. And that's what got the major play. And I think it kind of flushed out what we should have taken from this album, because like you mentioned, Who Shot You, everything else on this album is dope, man. This is a very good album, and I don't think people really understand it, because when they look at the track listings, the first thing they look at is these singles, you know. And the singles are dope, don't get me wrong, and radio, I understand why people in radio took to it. But no, you remove these, I'll put it like this, you can remove the singles from this album and this album will still carry itself.
I would like to mention, I just to put this in the future GOAT category file, that this album, incredible album. I mean, dope. Like I said about Foxy Brown having a complete album, this album is also complete because it has literally something for everybody.
Yeah, it's dope.
And even the songs that's, you know, that wasn't necessarily made for you, you also like. So you're like, I ain't come here for no, oh, but Hey Lover is dope. You know, or I ain't come here for none of, oh, that I Shot Just Freeze. You know, so even if you didn't even come for that, it's still good. But to put it in the GOAT file, this album that he produced came off incredible. 11 years after his debut. I mean, so for people that's like, yo, you know, he, of course, he had his first three albums, his classics, and then, yeah, this is 11 years later. This is a sixth album. Still dope. Still dope guy. Say that about anybody else. Anyway, I mean, if you want, I don't think you can name another MC that can do that 11 years later.
What the fuck? I thought I conquered the world. Crush Mo-D, Hammer, and Ice-T's girls. But still, niggas wanna instigate shit. I battle any nigga in the rap game quick. Name the spot. I make it hot for your bitches. Female rappers too. I don't give a fuck, boo. Words, I'm here to crush all my peers. Rhymes of the month in the sauce for 20 years. Niggas scared. I'm detrimental to your mental state. I use my presidential Rolex to be the bait. Niggas fight. Glock. Your temple gets fucked, MCs. That fuck with LL, they gets bucked. That's real. What's up with that I Shot Ya deal? Light shit, niggas Slipknot had the bullet feel. New York appeal. In LA, they gangbang. But if you touch a mic, your motherfucking ass hang. That's facts. Niggas don't receive no type of slack. Cause if they do, their ass is always running back. Not this time, but next time, I'ma name names. LL. Shitting from on top of the game. I shot ya. I shot ya.
How you doing, Sean Carter? So
this guy.
So let's keep it going. Seven. What do you got? Seven.
Number seven, man. This album is it's interesting how this album came to be what it is. This album was all over the charts, but I ain't even talking about the charts. The streets really took to this album. And, you know, the people loved it, man. And it was just like almost like a breath of fresh air. Mm. And I think one of the things that people have to consider about this album is that they this group almost got dropped because the previous album did not sell well. Oh, who am I talking about? I'm talking about the Fugees.
I thought you were talking about Naughty by Nature.
The album is The Score. Incredible album. Of course, this album launches Lauryn Hill into superstardom. And, you know, the dope thing about this album is that it's flawless all the way through.
Is it?
The sad thing about this album is that this is the last Fugees album. There was never an album after that. And, you know, we're not going to get into what happened after that. But, you know, Lauryn went up, she took off and did her thing. You know, Wyclef took off and did his thing. Prize, you know, he went to the car wash and started working, I guess. I don't know. But nonetheless, The Score, man. Fugees. Seven.
This album was a critical success. And it had a lot of dope things on it. This is almost but not quite like your comment about Mr. Smith, where radio grabbed the singles and the rest of the album kind of just was just there. I say it's not quite because it was songs on that was not a single that I never needed to hear again. I never needed to hear The Beast again.
I like The Beast.
I didn't have to hear Manifest. I didn't have to hear Family Business. And I really didn't need to hear No Woman, No Cry again. Now, I'm not saying that No Woman, No Cry, you know, for the time when it came, I was like, hey, man, listen to this guy. Okay.
Right, right.
But now I'm good. I don't really have to hear it ever again. But love the skits. Though one of the skits made it in my podcast that I did that had the top skits. So I'll show you Flying Fist of Judah. You ain't gonna show me shit. Incredible.
Yo, that skit gets funnier every time. Like you never get tired of hearing it, right?
Yeah. And you know, I mean, Killing Me Softly. So I would love to just have a hip hop album in this top. In this top 10, I mean, I get it. It's technically a hip-hop album, but it's more of a...
Mm-mm, no, this is hip-hop.
I know it is. I know it is. It's not like Miseducation, which is not a hip-hop album. But this is... It's by default. Anyway, solid, though. I can't argue for that year. You cannot make a list for that year and not include this. Most people will have this number one or two when they talk about that year.
So I mean,
and a lot of it's because of critical success and sales, but it was still a solid album. You know what we like to do over here on my side of things. We like to concentrate and focus on straight hip hop, though. Hi there, I'm Eclectic.
This guy.
So what we're gonna do for number seven? Oh, incredible album. This is a solo debut album from a rapper that everybody knows. You can't do a solo debut. It's just like Karis One that had a solo self-titled. We know who you are. You've been in BDP for years. But anyway, this album came out
September 95. The Cool Genius of Rap.
Okay.
Cool G Rap released the album 4, 5, 6. If you never shot CeeLo, get familiar. This album, when you want to talk hip hop, see, if score's great, but if you want to talk hip hop, got to come over here. You got to come over here for no other reason than to listen to Fast Life. Fast Life, my opinion, I got the floor right now, is one of the greatest hip hop songs to come out in the 90s period. Lyrically. Features Nas and going back and forth with one of his idols, one of the people that a lot of people say he sounded like when he first came.
Hey yo, our lifestyle's exquisite. Yeah, yo, like a blizzard. It's quiet attire standing on ground with one pivot. Two players rocking silk, blazers and diamonds like glaciers. Lands with name brand seats reclining like a spacious. Bodies on ice, living tripe, rolling fixed up dice. Gambling grand, handling stamps, moves and shites. My bank rolls, got the cops coming in plain clothes.
Trying to arraign a game because of a fame, that's how the game goes. True. Right out the slammer with the fame and glamour. Cooking up grams with armor, hammer, supplying scramblers in Alabama.
Rub out faces and leave no traces. My aces got mad body cases, preserves faces at the horse races. Serving us gone, Viva Clico. Dimes look magnifico. Putting it cut in Saporico. Heat for foes. Shopping sprees with my fleet for clothes and Caribbean sweets. Deep ripping beats with flow.
Hey yo, we went from standing on blocks. Went out of stock, selling rocks to picking up stock at both docks with Glocks. It got poppy seed fields with $1 million bills. Packing on the blue steel. We keep surreal inside the battlefield.
Yeah, so here's a toast to the funds and things. Gun smokes and rings. Graveyards is buried with kings. Kings.
Incredible. Song It's a Shame. Both mixes are on the album. Her name is Tammy. Got a beach house in Miami. Rides around with a small jammy in her silk and satin panties. It's just...
Oh, shit.
It's a lot of stuff on this album. If you haven't heard it, if you only heard Fast Life, go grab the album. Listen to It's a Shame. Listen to Money on My Brain. Listen to Take 'Em to War with MF Grimm on it. Listen to Executioner Style. The album, kind of underrated, but it was probably his best-selling album. But it's a dark, boom-bappish, crazy album. So, but that's why I got it on there on the hip hop lyrical side of the game. I had to put it number 7.
You know what, man? I love this album, and I think I can understand why you have it there where you have it at 7. I think the masses probably won't agree as far as it, you know, this album.
Mm-mm.
And it's because the masses sleep on Cool G Rap, so mm-hmm. the masses are going to sleep on this album. And I think if you ask a cross section of people, there's probably a lot of people that they know Fast Life, but they don't know the joint with Mr. Grimm, and you know they don't know the other solid gems on this album.
People that's listening, you know, for one of the folks, just pretend at number 7 I put Soul Food by Goodie Mob in there, okay? And now we're back square.
But yeah, they're not going to, and I've talked about it on a previous podcast, you know, about how slept on he is, and you know, just the mere mention of Cool G Rap, and you'll have a segment of the population to say, oh yeah, I remember that guy, he's got that song, you know, and they can't tell you the song.
Mm.
So but they know the name, but they don't know the game. So I get it. I understand why Cool G Rap is on there. A very, very good song for 1995. Excuse me, a very good album for 1995. Yeah, you get no beat from me.
Yeah, everyone that's listening to this, I also want to remind you of a dual purpose of the things that I do on this podcast. I could have very easily put a Soul Food by Goodie Mob on there. I could have put Dog Food by the Dog Pound yes. on there. I could have yes. put East 1999 Eternal on there. You know, albums that you guys know and you've heard. If I wanted to get the popular vote.
Mm-hmm.
But what I also like to do on this podcast to shine a light on seldom, rarely heard things. I want you to open your mind, open your ears to new stuff that you haven't heard. And lyrically, 4, 5, 6 bodies, all the albums I just said. So, and so I want you, I also want, not only do I want to give you something that you might not have heard, I also want it to be quality. I want to give you some good content, and 4, 5, 6 is good content. That being said, 6, where you got 6?
All right, man, coming in at number 6, you know, it's hard not to fall victim to the sophomore slump in hip hop. Okay. You know, especially if your first album was a classic. Nasir Jones, man, it was written.
Was
coming
it written?
In at number 6? Yes, it was. Yes, it was, man. This album is phenomenal. Now, in talking about this album, and I had a couple conversations over Twitter, probably over the last few months, where I've come across the rare people who think that this is Nas's best album, which I don't know what planet they're on, but nonetheless, you know, hey, you know, you like it, I love it. Nonetheless, man, this is a phenomenal album. I Gave You Power, you know, so many songs. Of course, If I Rule the World, man, Affirmative Action. Come on, son. I mean, the message, I could go on and on. The tracks are dope, production's dope, Nas is incredibly dope. So yeah, I got number 6, man. It was written.
And listen, I can't argue. I mean, it's that that album, it was a tough one, because people were, that was one of the most anticipated albums like ever in hip hop, because Illmatic was only anticipated because The Source gave it 5 mics before it came out.
Before it came out, and all we had was the verse. All we had was the verse on the main Source joint, right?
Yeah,
Live at the Barbecue.
Yeah, Live at the Barbecue. But you also had Halftime, because Halftime was on the soundtrack of the movie.
Right.
This one was more anticipated because we heard Illmatic, so we knew. we knew what was supposed to come. And I'm gonna tell you, when I first heard It Was Written, I was severely disappointed.
What?
I'm telling you, when I first heard it, because I was expecting Illmatic 2, and I heard it started, the skit was terrible. The skit was awful on the intro. Then the first song, the message, I was like, okay. I was like, now this is, what was it? The message, I'm like, okay, here we go. Yep. Here we go. And then I was like, this is what the rest of the album is going to be. I mean, he had the production. I didn't, outside of the message, I didn't get a New York State of Mind beat. And I didn't get a Life's a Bitch. I didn't get those. I still got solid songs. And songs, listen, I'm not going to say anything bad about the album. I'm on board with it. But when I first heard it, it didn't grab me. I was just like, oh.
Okay.
I was like, oh, okay, well, it's Nas' new album. It's Nas' new album. I guess it's his thing. That's cool. Well, bye. But in retrospect, importantly, it's because of him. His rest of his albums weren't necessarily incredible, so it made that one even more dope. It's like, no, but it was written, was crazy. It was like, you know what? I guess it kind of was. Incredible album, man. I can't say anything bad about that.
No doubt.
Let me tell you what I planned to do at number, where are we at, number 7? 6.
No, we're 6.
What I planned to do was throw in a popular pick. I planned to throw in a soul food or dog pal, but it would have just been inauthentic. It just wouldn't have been, it wouldn't have been right, because I would never listen to these albums.
So, I do.
Of course you
Trust
do.
Me, I do.
But the mere fact that, this is what I want to do. I wanted to put one of those albums there just to show people how dope the year was, that these albums that most people like, most people enjoy, wasn't even on the list.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you go to 1996, most of the honorable mentions that my friend is probably going to say, it could be solid albums, but most people would be like, that's cool. But we'll see. Like I was saying earlier, we like the hip hop over here. So what we're going to do, what we're going to do on this side of town, we're going to go with the curveball.
Okay.
And what we're going to do with the curveball here, everyone, I'm going to give you another debut album by a crew out of Brooklyn.
Okay.
They had a couple of different names. The album is called The Shining by Smith and Wesson. This album, unadulterated dope. Recognize is on this album. Soundboy Burial is on
Love
this
that
album.
Joint. Love that joint.
Bucktown is on this album.
Home of the original Gun Clappers.
Just want you to know how dope this album is. Again, this is one of those albums that you're going to listen to this podcast and be like, huh? But fucking Safe and Sound by DJ Quick came out that year. I know it did. I know you love that. I know that you love Cocktails by Too Short. But what I want you to know, I want you to listen to The Shining. I want you to get engrossed into the boot camp click. You need to listen to Steel and Tech. And just peep how different this is comparative to some of these albums that you're expecting to hear on this list. Like, this is hip hop right here. I had to put it on the list. I had to let this anchor the bottom half of the list.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I hear you. Mm-hmm. I mean, you get no argument from me, man. The Shining was that shit was tight, man. It's one of those albums that when you listen to, even to this day, you still get something from it, man. And I mean, like my favorite joint on there was Bucktown. Well, at least one of my favorite joints on there was Bucktown. And I mean, that when the beat comes on, man, you know what time it is. And one of the dopest things is if you're somewhere, a lounge, or if you do the club thing and it comes on, people bug the fuck out. They lose their mind. Like, you don't think of Bucktown as a something that you could, you know, two-step to it or whatever, shake your ass or whatever, but people love it. Yeah. And that whole album, man, love
that
it.
Joint, and that Soundboy Burial, it's
another favorite track on
it's, album. It's nothing you can do about it. Okay, so listen, as far as the albums are concerned, we're at halftime now.
Mm-hmm.
So let's take a quick break.
Yeah.
And we could compose ourselves, and when we get back, we're gonna go with the top five of 1995 versus 1996.
Yes,
see who wins on the album side of the game. After this,
yeah.
What's up, y'all? What you got to say? Who's on the tape with the hot DJ?
Yes, yes, y'all.
Yes, y'all.
Be the Fat Five representing boot camp and jump down in the ride.
Well, that sound cool, and that may be, but where you representing in the NYC?
Brownsville.
Hill, aka Bucktown, USA, where we rob motherfuckers, split the money five ways.
Word is bond, that nigga Sean don't give a fuck about none of y'all bitch ass niggas, for real. Pack still, never sell drugs because crack kill. Stack bills where my lyrics remain fact filled. My style similar to none, son, so it seems. Savages get sewn up with shots till they scream. Beans at night, help the big rock the right rhymes. Fight crime, golf cycle Devon, drop bombs on the blind. Who's this lunatic, soon to kick tunes that fit, make you your bitch. Fall under these niggas with that booming shit. You can get a dick in your mouth if you don't know. I rock and rock them, do constantly and let the brains blow. You remain slow, I'm hyped with this mic device. Grabbing my knife, stabbing up Mike Weiss tonight.
When I puff, lie out of a chalice. It makes me swift just like E. Smith from Dallas. And baby, I'm the greatest like Alice as the wildest. MC from East Coast, cause half of y'all are too stylish. Smash you, fuck. What block you be on? Won't come by like Dior. To your great sight, I be on. Now we running shit, dishing out all the punishment. But my friends can leave the mister from in front of it. On the blunted tip, you know everything is nature. Chill with Papa, not smoking on Pronto from Jamaica. Don't think twice, I've been nice since the first day. With your girl undercover like New York on the Thursday. Mr. Strain, paint that ass like a picture frame. Hit it twice, and I didn't even get the bitch's name.
Me and Natty Dread, Natty Dread, do what? Take them heads on the rock. Do a roll call. I thought we told y'all them heads ain't ready for the Armageddon.
Shoo-dee, shoo-dee, wop do wop. Here with the man live is the Fat Five. Original gun clappers, the batter, original gun stature. Tory, if you didn't know, end of story. Built like Lego, heads there you say no to this, cause it's just the tub of universal stats.
Ask me who's the baddest, I'll be the gladdest like that. Why them faggots are scared of fist fights? Because they PD parties smell like Punani. Trying to use boot camp on the way to try to guard the
rash on his ass. Move too slow, niggas, they slide like Joe. I make your dreads grow like that limo.
Welcome back to the show. It's 95 versus 96. It's me, Eclectic, what's up? And 12 Kyle without the at in front, because we're on the podcast. We're not on social media right now. We're debating on which was the better year for hip hop, 1995 and 1996. Now, so far, we went over, we're discussing albums, right? And you think your bottom five is better than my bottom five?
Yeah, I think so. I think I'm winning by a round. You know, I think you came with some you got the KRS-One joint, the Me Against the World, which you know, like I said, is my favorite album from Tupac. Mr. Smith again, you know, an album that I was able to revisit here recently and really appreciate it outside of the singles. And then 4, 5, 6, man, you can't go wrong with the Cool Gangsta Rap. So now you came with a really, really good list. Your list is slightly lesser than mine.
Okay, so the way I'm looking at these albums, I'm looking at these albums based on content. I'm not looking at sales. We don't do sales here on the podcast.
No, we don't
give a damn
about sales.
And
John Luke sold a lot of records.
He sure did. and he wrote none of them. Shout outs to Young MC. My boy didn't know that Young MC wrote Tone Loc's greatest hits.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
He thought Tone Loc wrote it himself?
Well, I mean, it's like he performs them. Let me ask a question. What do you think, out of the five that I threw out there, what's the weak link?
I would, kind of hard to call it a weak link because it is a personal favorite of his discography, but I would say Me Against the World is the weak link.
Okay, that's the weak link. Okay, that's fair. All right, so now let's see what you have on yours. You had the Fugees. Yeah, it was written.
It was written. Iron Man, All Eyes.
All Eyes on Me.
Il Nana.
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm going to have to say that All Eyes on Me is the weak link over there, too. Listen, man, this is not Tupac Slander Podcast. It's not. We promise it's not.
It's not. It's really not.
It's just when you're going by content, you're going by hip-hop, you're going by dopeness. It's just, he's... Now,
and
listen,
there's really
if this was
only
the,
one of us that liked Tupac on this podcast.
Yeah. And if this was the all-impact podcast, the guy would be number one.
All impact matters.
Yeah, if this was all-impact podcast, all-impact matter, hashtag... The guy would be number one, man.
Oh, he'd be number one with a bullet, for
yeah,
real.
With a big silver bullet. Schlitz smoke liquor.
Oh gosh, that's funny.
So, all right, let's get back to it. We're gonna go with our top five albums, and then we'll revisit and see
and whose 10 is the most solid. You're up. What do you got at 5?
All right, number 5. I've often said, man, that my 5 from 1996, depending on who you ask, I think you could really make a case for any of them being number 1. As far as how dope these albums are. And it really just depends on who you ask. I think most will have my number 1 at number 1, but we'll get to that in a second. But you can flip-flop the 5 around, really. All right, so coming in at number 5, my afro blows in 360 degrees. So this makes me the light-skinned Richard Roundtree. Come on, man.
Not his verse, though, but
okay. Not his verse, but you know what album I'm talking about.
That is my favorite song off that album.
And that's why I gave it to you. Muddy Waters from Redman. For those of you who've been following us, you know that me and E did a podcast on this particular album. I had to get him on the podcast because the podcast just wouldn't have been right without him. I mean, we both love this album, man. This album, on any given day, I think you could listen to it no matter what. And this is one of the albums that I'd like to say in this particular 5, my 5, for me, no skips. So this album right here, no skips. Like, I listened to this album all the way through. This is an album, even though it was made 20 years ago, some 20 plus years ago, I still listen to this album at least maybe 2 or 3 times a month. And I can say that for each of these 5 that I'm going to name. Dope album. It is my favorite album from Redman. Redman's one of my favorite MCs. I love it, man. I love it. This album is my number 5. Redman, Muddy Waters.
Can't really say anything bad about it. I mean, it's an incredible album. It's probably in my, it's probably my 3rd favorite album of Redman, maybe.
Okay.
Maybe 3rd.
Wait. What are you putting higher than Redman? Just curious.
What in Dark Side?
Okay. Oh, so you did say they go 1, 2, 3 for you.
Yeah,
as far as how he was released. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you can't go wrong with it, though.
No.
Because, you know, and Tonight's my favorite Redman song. Gotta go with mine. Yeah, incredible. I can see it at number 5. I thought personally you would have that lower. I see that you're not going for the popular folk. You're going you're giving the hip-hop
honestly,
head something.
I mean, like, I could honestly, man, I could make a case for this being the best album in 1996. No lie. I could make a case. Now, most people won't agree, but I could make a case. I just love this album that much.
Okay. Nothing wrong with
what you got at number 5?
My number five album. It's a very. It was nominated for a Grammy Award for the best rap album.
Okay.
It's one of the Source's top 100 albums. Which, you know, how could it not be? It's the return to the 36 Chambers colon the dirty version. Oh, Dirty Bastard.
Yes.
Listen, I'm going to tell you a quick story. I did not have this particular album when it came out. I wasn't completely sold on old DB. And I couldn't imagine how this dude could do a whole album.
Whole album.
With that style. So I was like, yeah, nah. And, you know, Brooklyn Zoo came out. I was like, this shit. Crazy, all right, okay. And then I'm like, but still. And then Shimmy Shimmy Y'all came. I'm like, wait a minute, man. This dude is. And I'm like, nah. So what happened was, one day, I was chilling. I was like, this is the beauty of the 80s and the 90s, you know, early mid 90s. Sometimes she's just like, I'm going to buy some hip hop. And you would just go and get something. You was like, there's nothing else to do. Let me go to the record store. And I did that. And Old Dirty Bastard's CD was in a discount bin.
Wow.
For $5.
blasphemy.
And I was like, well, I cannot get it for $5. It's like, this is crazy. So I was like, even if it's terrible, I mean, that was just, it was like a Happy Meal at this point. I'm like, I can't. So I got it, went back home, threw it in, and, you know, Shimmy Shimmy Ya's first song. Then Baby Come On, I'm like, oh. And then Brooklyn Zoo came, so I was like, okay. Hepper to the Hopper. I'm like, this album. And then they hit me with Rawhide. I'm like, this. I was like, at that, by the time I got to song like 8, halfway through, I was like, this is the best solo release out of the world. This is better than Takao, and this is better than everything. But the album is incredible. If people slap on, I don't know how you could have possibly done that. But if you did, you have to get it. I had to put it in my upper half of this list. Return to the 36.
Oh man, no doubt that album, man. Much like you, I had the same thought when I bought it. I don't know how he's gonna take that style and deliver that over 13, 14 tracks for an hour. But without hesitation, man, I bought the album the day that it came out. Never forget, because I saw the album cover, and you know, we knew when albums coming out. Albums back then came out like every Tuesday, and I remember going to the record store and getting it, man. It didn't disappoint me at all, man. I'm I've often said this. ODB he's not the best MC in the Wu, but he's my favorite MC in the Wu. My favorite character, man, because I think we all knew somebody like ODB. So yeah, I bought the album, loved it, played it to death, and I could definitely understand why you got that in the top five, man. That's a very, very solid album.
Yeah, man. Let's keep it moving, man. Four, what you got it for?
Four, man. Again, I can make a case. I can make a strong case for this at number one. This group is so dope to me, and they're dope to a lot of people. But I wish they were even more popular than what they are.
Naughty by Nature.
Oh, LL.
Hey, they better than
This album is phenomenal. Production is phenomenal. Like I said, De La Soul. Stakes is
and bass up the track a little bit, because I want to hear that.
This is my joint, man. Another album that I listen to, you know, at least two or three times a month, even to this day, and the album never gets old. Where the argument comes in with De La really is where you place this in the, where someone may place this in their personal discography. But for me, this album, like, again, I can make a case that it's one. It's flawless front to back. You don't have to be a De La Soul fan to love this album. And I'm going to tell you something, man. I still have yet to meet one person to tell me that this album, that they don't like this album. One. Nobody's never told me that. If you listen to this podcast and you think you don't like this album, I'll fight you. I'm just that serious about this. And I can't say that about every album, are you? Because you can make a case for why you wouldn't or would like a particular album. This album, flawless, man. De La Soul coming in at number four for me.
Well, I am a huge De La Soul fan, so
for sure,
you're not gonna get any back talk from me about it. I am sure that most people who are not the hardest of hip hop heads would scratch a part of their anatomy at this selection, but you people, I will tell you that this is a solid selection, and if I were doing the list for that year, it would definitely be it'd probably be in my top three, because I am pretty sure what else my friend is gonna say for his top three, and I know damn sure that one of them would not even be on my list. So I'm going to say that that Stakes is a very solid selection.
All right.
Yeah.
I'm not even anticipating this. So for number four, I have yet another debut album. It's a lot of debut albums on my side. And when you have debut albums, typically you have people's best effort. Just want to say that. You got a lot of people's second and third choice. Just throwing that out there if you want to, you know, say who's the best. This particular album was very anticipated because of my guy's cameo on a very classic album. Well, we like to call him as the New York City 90s era Sosa. Anthony Cruz, AC. The mm-hmm. album, Do or Die. Shout outs to Whole Happy Jackie.
Oh, I love that joint.
So, again, this album, I don't need to say a lot about this album. When it came out, some people was just like, nah. But a lot of people was like, this album's crazy. I happen to be on the crazy side. We got my favorite AZ song of all time, Rather Unique. Sugar Hill.
Yes.
Give Me Yours. Oh, Happy Jackie. But the jewel, Mo Money, Mo Murder.
Mo Murder.
Mo Homicide. Lyrically, might be the best song come out that year. Lyrically. And a mahogany, black scenery.
That was lightning and raindrops. I'm tied up in a basement cocaine spot like Bangkok. I'm blindfold, Vietnam type, mind control is torture. His accent sounds like the rarest culture. Asking me, my atrophy stabbing me gradually. Says his attribute was satanic, masonic, ironic. I felt reminded of my fast life ventures and winters, blinded till the flashlight enters.
Yo, done, before the sun set, call connect, get all the texts. I'm vexed, this nigga soft as sex, lost respect, let's off his neck. My caliber got me thinking on a higher algebra. See me, I'm just as foul as ya, but you ain't got no stallion. I'm in the bigger cheddar, G's and better, armor betters, Armani sweaters, plus these crabs can never dead us.
Incredible.
More money, more motor, more.
Go ahead,
hey, son. You get no argument from me, man. I love that album. I will say this. I think if you ask a lot of people, they probably don't have that album as high.
Oh,
but
no,
I have no qualms with where it's ranked and the particular selection of the album. Another joint that I actually remember purchasing in 1995. And my joint was Whole Happy Jackie, man. Like, I used to just play it all the time just riding around campus because I was in college at the time at South Carolina State University. Yeah, man, this album is, you know, much like AZ, really, really slept on by the masses. Mm-hmm. But when you go back and listen to it, man, it's so many jewels on this joint, man. So many jewels. And again, you don't have to be an AZ fan to appreciate it, but AZ fans understand how dope this album is. And, you know, you could make a case for it actually being higher. I don't think the masses will put it that high, but I'm not knocking. I mean, that's at three, dope as hell.
Listen, I'm thinking over here on this side, man. I got a strong pull for winning this album title. Now I know that I'm gonna be a little bit behind the eight ball because of I'm about to guess what your top three is gonna be. I'm not gonna say it out loud. I'm just gonna think it through really quick. All right,
mm-hmm.
So we know that this one is in there.
Mm-hmm,
and then, mm-hmm. And then, so, and that one's probably in there.
For shizzle.
Okay. And so then, there is, it is possible, because what number are we on?
We're on three.
Right. It is possible that your top three could all be done by groups.
That's not possible.
It is possible. I didn't say that you did. I'm saying it is a strong argument that your top three could be groups if you think about it the way that I'm thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
But you said it's not. So, Oh no, it's not. It should have been. It could have been. But all right. So I know what your top three. Your top three is two groups and a guy.
This guy, man.
Right? Am I right?
Do you want me to just...
No, stop it. Am I right? It's two groups and a guy.
Maybe. I don't know. I need to take a look and
see. I think it's two groups and a guy.
Coming in at number three, folks. Hey, man. I'll stay right here in ATL, man, where I live.
Hey, thank you for listening to the show. We will, in the meantime, in between time to next time, we out.
Ladies and gentlemen, hey, man, y'all know me. Y'all know what it is, man. ATL, ATLians, man, Outkast. This album, now my friend over here is sighing all over my section, but it's okay. Give him some 44D, he'll be all right. nonetheless, shout out to Eddie. Nonetheless, man, this album is phenomenal. I've heard people argue about where they rank it as far as their discography, as far as Outkast is concerned. But, it comes off with You May Die intro, Two Dope Boys in a Cadillac. And ATLians, The Wheels of Steel, of course, Elevators, Me and You, Your Mama and Your Cousin too, Rolling Down the Strip on Vogue's, coming up, Slamming Cadillac Doors. I know that's your favorite, E. But yeah, I won't go any further, folks. Number three, ATLians, straight right here in A-Town, my hometown. So what can I say? You don't need to rebut, man. Just give me
number three that I have on my list.
I love it.
Number three, which is a much better album than what I just heard. Also comes from a member of the Wu-Tang Clan.
Okay.
This album is called Liquid Swords.
Yeah.
This album, again, listen, we're doing hip hop on this side of town. This is we're concentrating on the lyrics and the boom bap and the we got I Got Your Back. We got Cold World. We got Liquid Swords, the title track. We got Shadow Boxing. I breaks it down to the bone gristle. Fourth Chamber. Camouflage Chameleon, they're just killing your building. No time to grab the gun, they already got your wife and children. Investigative Reports.
Yes, love that joint.
Labels, Tommy Ain't My Motherfucking Boy.
Boy.
If you're living in the world today, there's nothing on this album you don't like. I can't say anymore, man. Liquid Swords, the genius, man. This guy's incredible.
I love it. I love this album, man. I think this album, is... It's hard to really put into words what this album is. This album is everything. And, you knew coming into it that if nothing else, you were going to have dope production because RZA produced it. And you were going to have dope rhymes because, the genius never came. He's never going to come whack, right? So I think this album, man, I have no problem with it being at number three. I will say this much. There's a lot of people who aren't Wu-Tang fans that have never heard this album, and that's the tragedy of it. But other than that, it's a great album, man. Great album.
Yeah, those people that haven't heard this album.
Shame on you.
So I'm assuming that for your number two, we have a group.
Lost Generation, Fast Paced Nation. The principles of true hip hop have been forsaken. It's all contractual and about money making. Ladies and gentlemen, the legendary Roots Crew coming in at number two, Illadelph Half Life. What up? Oh my God. Let me tell you something, man. This album I listen to every week. Wow. No doubt about it. no skips. This album, man, I think really it really shows what the Roots are. They more than solidify themselves as not just a novelty act, but I mean, you have bars from, you know, Malik B and of course Black Thought. Dice Raw gets on here and rhymes. Common's on here. You know, they got D'Angelo, got D'Angelo on the joint. The great Raphael Sadiq. And you can't go wrong, man. You can't go wrong. This is, and I've heard people make a case for this being the best album of 1996. So you can laugh all you want. Love it. Roots coming in at number two.
I liked this album when it came out. Not much after that. when it first came out, I thought this album was second to none. And as I kept listening to it, I didn't want to listen to it anymore. But
you went with your first thought.
But you know, I love Episodes. I love the Hypnotic.
Yes.
What they do was good, and then you know it got played out.
But how about Push Up Your Lighter with Bahamadia?
I like Bahamadia's part.
Yes.
And Concerto de Desperado.
Yes.
But other than that, I don't really. I'm fine with everything else. I don't even. I could never listen to anything. No Alibi, maybe, but I could. You know, I didn't like it as much as I wanted to when it first came out, and it was new. I was like, this is crazy. But then, like, I guess when other albums came out, or I listened to stuff that already came out more. That's what happened. I listened to other ones more. I can't even fix my face to say that this is a whack album because it's not. I couldn't possibly do that. Clones was like, and then a lot of the videos turned me off of the songs too. Like Clones, I thought Clones was dope, and I watched the video. I'm like, ah. But yeah, this is very solid. I'm surprised that you didn't have hardcore. That you could have had.
Oh, Lil Kim.
Yeah. What? This is what I thought. Can I say what I thought? Because anybody with half a brain knows right. What your number
knows
one is.
Knows what number one. Right.
But so I thought back when I was saying that you, I thought Nocturnal was gonna be up there. I thought Nocturnal was gonna be. And I know we can get to honorable mentions. Yeah, so I don't want you to blow your shoot your okay. But that's what I had thought. Because you know. Anybody with half a brain knows that Machiavelli's your number one. So anyway, and once we started to do this podcast, everybody knows what my number one is.
And that would be?
World number two.
Okay, I'm sorry. I forgot. Well, yeah, world two.
Yeah, world two. But it's, I mean, come on. Number two, what I have here. Because we're doing hip-hop over here. And that's what we do. This album. It's the second album from this group. But no one listened to their first album, so it doesn't matter. The Infamous. Arguably.
Yes, sir.
The hardest album to come out that year, maybe in the 90s.
It might have been the hardest album in the 90s.
Yes.
Period.
Yes. Survival of the Fittest. What up, son? Up North Trip. Drink Away the Pain. Shook Ones Part 2. People like, where's Part 1? Don't worry about it.
Yeah, don't worry about it. We got it.
Temperatures Rise. Give Up the Goods and Get Sprayed. But nothing compares to I for I. Your beef is mine. Listen, arguably, Afrenai's better song is better than his whole list. I'm telling you, what's going down with this song? This song is crazy. Havoc verse is crazy. This is how dope that's. And anyway, look, Infamous, is 15, 16 tracks of pure, unadulterated dope. Party's over, tell the rest of the crew.
Mm-hmm. Hey, man, so I had to put Infamous at number two.
You know what, man? You get no argument from me. I think you could. This album is funny because, like, when it came out, I remember copping it. And actually, for some reason, I have two CDs of this album. I don't know why to this day I still have two CDs, but I still have two CDs. But, like, it was years later before I heard Juvenile Hell. So I went a long time thinking, like, this was their debut album. But, yeah, man, there's not one track on here that I don't like. And again, like you said, the hardest album in the 1990s period. Man, they crushed it, man. Rest in peace to Prodigy. Incredible album. I love it. Love it to this day. Still play it.
Yeah, man. It's not much you can say. I mean, shouts to the rapper Noid. Mm. Incredible album. Now listen, now we're at number one. And there's no question of what your number one is. There's no question of my number one is. But since you're a big fan, I'm going to let you wax poetic and tell everybody what your number one, the greatest hip-hop album to come out in 1996, man. Is. The answer is?
The answer, I mean, it's pretty obvious, is the classic, Reasonable Doubt, Sean Corey Carter, Jay-Z, Jigga, whatever you want to call him. It's so much I could say, but I'm not going to filibuster and ramble about this album. It's a classic. You know, it was an album, and don't get it twisted, folks. Contrary to popular belief, when this album came out, people weren't really checking for it. I mean, it was a few people checking for it, but what I'm saying is, like, the masses, like, this album, as far as record sales, again, we don't talk record sales, but as far as record sales, this album didn't go platinum until, like, maybe 5 or 6 years later. Like, so it wasn't a very, very popular album on the charts, but the streets loved it. And, you know, Jay-Z, man, he started off, and this was, you know, his baby, and everybody loved it. And, you know, it got major play in the streets. And, like, for me, a major play in the dorm and car and everything like that. There's so much I could say about this album. I did a podcast about it. It is an album that I listen to every week. And yeah, man, Jay-Z, number one.
Incredible album. It's probably still his greatest album.
Yes.
I really anticipated it because I was a Jay-Z fan since the 80s. I was one of the few that knew a lot of his first joints back, you know, jazz era and everything. I used to know the whole original Originators that came out, was it 86? By heart, I knew it. Mm. 86, 88. And I used to tell people about Dude, but no one knew because he was never, you know, I was like, nah, the dude with, and he rap fast. He's, no, okay, well. And so, once he was with Original Flavor, I said, look, that's that dude. People still like, no, because they only showed the Original Flavor video twice.
Right, right. You never saw the video.
And so when Dead Presidents come, I'm like, this is the dude I've been telling you about for like 10 years. And I remember the first time, and so this is the first time I heard Ain't No. We didn't know what to do with ourselves, man. because we already knew Fox from 1995.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, when Ain't No came out, Foxy was the important one. She was the famous one. It was like, how he get her? Who is he to have her on his album, on his song, and that the sample and everything, man. When that album came out, I thought, yeah, this is it. This is about to be that next Illmatic. Then, as I listened to it more, I'm not a fan of the majority of the album. I'm gonna tell you the truth, but I cannot
say that that album isn't probably the greatest album to come out that year. And the, some of the songs on there, it's just ridiculous. The Reasonable Doubt joint, Can I Live?
Favorite song. That's my favorite song.
Can I Live, Politics as Usual, and Feeling It, those three are in the top 10, 15 songs to come out the entire year, in my opinion. So, I mean, all from one album. It's, you know, it's a lot of songs. Regrets is crazy. I love Regrets. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I hate Cashmere Thoughts. I couldn't stand the Evils. Fucking 22 Twos was stupid to me. But Politics as Usual, Can I Live, Can't Knock the Hustle. Oh, the Can't Knock the Hustle remix. Oh, incredible album. Love it. Love it. Love it. Well done.
Appreciate it.
Listen, everybody. Hi, how you doing? It's Eclectic here from the Eclectic Discussion Podcast and Encyclopedia Hip Hop. How you doing? My number one is better than every album that we've already discussed. Both years. Both years.
No.
The album is so dope, we don't even call it by its name. We call it by its color. If we don't call it by its color, we use initials. It's the only one with a sequel. What I'm talking about is the Purple Tape.
Mm-hmm.
Arguably, top three albums to come out in the 90s, period. Not 95, not 96, not 97, not 98, not 91, 2, 3, or 4. Period. You got Illmatic, and then...
Reasonable Doubt.
Then this.
Then the Purple Tape.
You will not find a single person that will say Reasonable Doubt is better than the Purple Tape.
I will find a bunch of people that will say Reasonable Doubt is better than the Purple Tape.
Challenge, produce them. So, the Purple Tape came out and it pretty much changed the game. For better or for worse, it changed the entire game. All of a sudden, people got AKAs and aliases, and people are wearing crazy stuff, and women are wearing ice cream flavors on the shirts. everything changed after the Purple Tape. It wasn't for the Purple Tape. A lot of the stuff that happened in 96 wouldn't have happened. So, we're talking Rainy Days. We're talking Glaciers of Ice. We're talking Wisdom Body. We're talking Ice Cream. Criminology. Just, can it be also simple? The remix. And then you get Verbal Intercourse.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Nas, Ray, and Ghost. They got the best product on the block. I don't need to say anything about this. As my friend did a podcast on Reasonable Doubt, I did a podcast on the Purple Tape. And go listen to that if you get a chance. Even if you don't get a chance, play it anyway. You know, play it while you're vacuuming and doing your homework. Or play it on your way to work. Play it while you're at your desk in your cubicle. Play it for your boss. It's nothing else I need. As we say that Raising Hell has the greatest, shortest song in the history of hip hop, mm-hmm. This album has the greatest giggle in the history of hip hop.
Yes, yes. So, White Mad Styles.
Because it's a bit of a nah shit. So, listen, it's the Purple Tape, man. It was probably the second greatest album to come out in the 90s. That's what it is.
I would probably say that the Purple Tape is the third best album to come out in the 90s, and that's no knock on the Purple Tape. Hands down, man, I agree with 1,000% of what you just said, man. The Purple Tape is nobody had these mafioso aliases or nothing like that until, because, you know, the Wu were, they were so much, they were ahead of the curve, and they were so they were very good trendsetters, if you will. And even some of the rhyming styles and the patterns and the subject matter that they were talking about. And man, it doesn't get any better than the Purple Tape, man. The Purple Tape, I think, is, you know, and for those of you listening, if you haven't figured it out by now, it's Raekwon's Only Built for Cuban Links. We call it the Purple Tape because when the tape came out, the tape was purple. And if you bought the CD was purple. So, you know, it's the Purple Tape. I don't think I should have to explain that to everybody, but just in case you don't know. But yeah, man, I agree 100%, man. The Purple Tape is one of those albums, man, that you never get tired of listening to it. And it's got so many different joints, so many different flavors. And, you know, it's kind of like a semi Wu-Tang album because you got other members of the Wu, but then he also brought in, you know, the likes of Nas. And
other members, Cat's, you like, have all of the members. Yeah,
exactly. All the members. I think, does ODB might be the, is ODB, I can't remember, if, or just off the top if ODB is on it. But he, if not, he's the only one that probably doesn't make the album, and because he might have been high somewhere. Yeah.
Everybody else, though.
Yeah, but everybody else. But yeah, man, 95, man, solid list, solid pull. I mean, again, Only Built for Cuban Links. If you have not heard that album, shame on you. You need to go listen to it as soon as you finish this podcast.
Okay. So we just ran down the top 10, what we thought albums were for 1995 versus 1996. This is the first of a series of three podcasts where we're going to try to battle this out. What we're going to do is we're going to take one more break. Then we're going to come back, sum up this list, stater cases why 110 is better than the other, and then we're gonna get out of here.
Yeah.
But it's not over, motherfuckers. After this.
Yes, yes, y'all. I still fame by any means to flow, and I go through extremes, don't intervene. My invention show like a three-dimensional screen, cause I mention many things and I'm presenting many scenes. I guess I'm telegraphic, motion's energetic. Better tell them forget it, cause I'm telekinetic. Ideas is growing, mics is blowing from what I'm showing. See it, I keep it going when I'm flowing. I get visual, seeds of the lyrical individuals, critical. Nothing kids could do, I'm coming through. I get visual, seeds of the lyrical individuals, critical. Nothing kids can do, I'm coming through. Poetical pages cause panic. Freestyle's frantic, thoughts is organic. Flow is aerodynamic, mic is volcanic. Rhymes spread across the planet. I send out the scribe, now the vibe's gigantic. Now, I'm internationally known, mental capacity's blown. I hope your mic with phones, accident phone. Raw footage is shown, but only showing scenes of my own. Putting your peripheral vision in the zone. But not the twilight, from the insight that I write and recite in my mic. I'll be bright, cause I like the night glow. It's out of sight what I'm showing. Rappers are knowing. I keep it going when I'm flowing. I get visual.
Welcome back to the show. We're wrapping this up. It's 95 versus 96, the album edition. I'm Eclectic. I got 12 Kyle here. So listen, I did 10. You did 10. I'm going to ask you a question straight up.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think, in your heart of hearts, mm-hmm, that your 10 in totality is a better collection of albums than the 10 that I sent?
Okay, what did you have for 6? Because I don't have a 6 written down for you.
Got the,
I got
Shining.
4, 5, huh?
The Shining.
The Shining. Okay, let me write it down.
Now, okay. Listen, I'm going to say this. Whether you truly believe it or you're like, you know what? I would prefer your 10. It doesn't matter because it's not over. We got 3 rounds here. So it's not over.
So yeah, you know, looking at your list and what's interesting is that, like, I had not even glanced at any of the albums from 95. I know off the top of my head, you know, what came out in 95, but I'm very impressed with your list. I think you have a very good list. No, I take that back. Actually, you have a great list. I would say 95 comes in maybe 2 points short of 96. I think 96 gets the edge because 90s, I think the albums that I listed have more balance, and I think these albums are overall better albums. I think that there's going to be some people that listen to this podcast is going to, the first thing they're going to say, and you actually addressed it, they're going to ask, where is Soul Food? Where's Dog Food? Two albums that probably is going to make a lot of people's list that didn't make yours. I understand why you didn't put them on yours. Mm-hmm. Looking at your list, Soul Food and Dog Food would probably make the list. I'm not sure where I would put them. Mm-hmm. They'd be in the bottom. I'd probably get rid of Pac. They'd be in the bottom half. Nonetheless, I think you got a great list, man. I think yours is slightly less than mine. Slight.
Okay. So what my friend is here saying that in the first of three rounds, he's scoring his a 10-8. I'm scoring it for me 10-9. I'm not gonna belittle his list that bad.
I'm not belittling.
No. Listen, you did yours. You said you said 2 points. So he's scoring a knockdown. I don't know where my list got knocked down, but he's scoring a knockdown. He's saying 10-8. I'm going 10-9. Mm-hmm. Going 10-9 because of all of the filler. As so in All Eyes on Me. I'm going with the fact that revisiting some of the top albums that he has, I don't find them as compelling as they did when they first dropped. A lot of the things, since we're looking back, I'm looking back at, you know, the replay. Now, he says, look, he plays some of these things every week. And I'm looking at, if someone handed me some of these albums, would I listen to them all the way through? And I couldn't do that for Ella Delph and Reasonable Doubt. I could definitely do it for Muddy Waters. Definitely.
ATLNs?
I definitely could do it for Iron Man. I definitely could do it for Stakes Is High. Definitely. I still listen to those. But I couldn't do it for the majority of the top five that he has on his list. And so if those are the best of the best, I can't even listen to It Was Written all the way through.
Yeah, I'm not going back listening to Liquid Swords all over again.
Whoa. You had your part when you were...
Well, you're breaking it down like that.
Well, that's how I choose to break it down. You broke it down the way you wanted to. And you go over there and sit down. So the reason why I scored 10-9 for me is because while personally... I wouldn't want to listen to these all the way through. I respect their position and how other people would view them. But I took back how, you know, a lot of the albums that you have on your list, and it's, you know, hey, it's because of the year, maybe. It's not their best album. It's not their best work.
Well, we were going by the year.
I know. Look at that. Mm-hmm. And fortunately, for me, my year had that particular artist, a lot of their best work. It's just a fortunate thing. It just happens that way. Just so happens that The Purple Tape came out. Just so happens that The Infamous came out. The Infamous is the best Mobb Deep joint. The Liquid Swords is just his best. The Door Dies AC's best. The Old Dirty Bastard's best. Coogee Rap's best. Tupac's best, according to some people. So it just so happens the dominoes fell that way. So that's why I'm scoring it a win for me. Now, that being said, we're gonna list these albums, and then I'm gonna put it out to the people. We're gonna have a mm-hmm. poll, and you tell us which 10 you would rather listen to. If they said, look, you're gonna make a playlist. 10, you can only have these 10 albums. Which 10 would you pick? And when we get the results on the next show or a future show, we'll bring it up. Now, mm-hmm. before we get out of here, do you want to go through your honorable mentions? You want to mention Machiavelli and Razzcast?
Oh, you already know, man. Yeah, I've got some that you know didn't make the cut, mm-hmm. but definitely honorable mentions. Mm-hmm. In no particular order. Yeah. You mentioned Nocturnal,
which I would have put on the list. I would have took something off your list.
Man, let me tell you something, man. Some people say Sean Price is nice on mic devices. I mean, that album, man. Again, I could easily make a case for it. It just fell out of my top 10, but you can make a case for it being in the top. Some people would make a case for it being in the top 5, and I would have no argument whatsoever. So Nocturnal, the aforementioned Soul on Ice by Raz Kaz, Hell on Earth by Mobb Deep, which was their follow-up to your selection for The Infamous. It wasn't as good as The Infamous, but I mean, it's hard to beat what The Infamous was. Mm-hmm. It's a very, very dope ass solid follow up to The Infamous. Mm-hmm. Riding Dirty, UGK. Whew, the South. One of the albums that put the South on the map. Shout out to Bun B and Pimp C, rest in peace. Mm-hmm. The aforementioned Hardcore, Lil' Kim. You know, for those who like that style of rhyming and that style of subject matter, you know, I mean, you know, shout out to the album cover and the posters. Those were dope. You know, not a personal favorite, but a very solid album. Like mentioned Machiavelli albums. Now, I mean, and talk to some of the kids that would actually put this in their top 10. It doesn't fall in my top 10. I think this album kind of trails off at the back half of it. But nonetheless, a phenomenal album. Shout out to Hail Mary, which was, you know, a great song on that album. What else? West Side Connection was another one. Honorable mention. No. I mean, Beef was heavy in 96. So West Side Connection really wept the West. Collage from Bahamadia
also should have been on the list.
Couldn't crack top 10. And this one wouldn't, you know, it was an album that came out in 1996. A lot of people liked it. I didn't like it as much as a lot of other people did, but you know, it deserves mention. The Coming, Busta Rhymes. And last but not least, man, you know, one of your personal favorites. Beats, Rhymes, Life, A Tribe Called Quest. It will be noted of my top 10. Let me see. Which one of these? Oh, if I'm not mistaken, this just to illustrate the point of how dope this list is and how dope these albums are. Mm. These albums dropped on consecutive weeks. Reasonable Doubt, Stakes Is High, and It Was Written. I mean, can you imagine that summer? You got those albums coming out back to back to back to. Come on, man. Yeah. So 96, man. That's my list, and that's my you know, honorable mention.
All right. I'm gonna make this brief. You know, honorable mentions. I mentioned a lot of albums that you know you guys would put out there. You would put Dog Food up there. You would put Soul Food up there. East 1999 Eternal. Shout outs to In a Major Way by E40. But we're talking hip hop. We're on the hip hop side of things over here on my list. So, you know, Kyle is more of a hip hop type of person. he's more of a popular, he's a popular guy. He likes a lot of the popular songs. I'm more of a B-side guy. I'm more of an album cut guy. My honorable mention stuff, you know, shouts to Showbiz and AG, the Goodfellas mm-hmm. album that came out. Mm-hmm. Shouts to Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous, the Big L album that came out. Jealous One's Envy, the quintessential mm-hmm. Fat Joe album. Double or Nothing by Eric Sermon. Hold It Down by Dos Effects. Last Chance No Breaks by Jamal. You could throw Conspiracy by Junior Mafia out there if you wanted to.
Yeah, I'd throw it out all right.
shout outs to The Natural by Mike Geronimo, though. Shout outs to the Show soundtrack from the movie. All We Got Is Us by Onyx. It's a 95 joint. The Nonce, the Friday soundtrack. The Loonies, if you want to do that. Group Home, if you want to do that. And an album that I did own, that nobody else on the planet that I know owned. Shout outs to the Milk Crate by Milkbone. Where the Party At and Keep It Real.
Sit back and talk about gats and glocks and busting caps on blocks, cracking on practice cops. You couldn't handle when I'm deep like a diver. The cookie corner canal keeps my streets live. I play the DL and watch the outskirts. I write an ill verse, I never shout words that makes my mouth hurt. I go to Boobie's place and rap the Boobie breaks, popping in a Fuji tape and watch all the moves we make. We're getting up until we're choking. I feel over in the tempo and beyond. I got the ball, but you're soaking. I generate the girls good night. I spread the hood like my lyrics and my style. Judgment. My ass ain't budging. I kill a fast dozen of your fam and fuck your last cousin. Straight from Jersey, doing just what I feel. Steal a meal, I'm the druggie to deal, but keep it real. Speed bumps, I roll a tree stump, so give a free blunt. I only had to smoke weed once to rap while I puff that and chill as I buff back and grab my nutsack and fairy crews who fuck fangs. See, I'm the broke bitch that you don't want to smoke with, but rhyming since the days of puffing joints out the road clips. I wake up every morning and I always wonder why peeps are OD, treat my streets like a slumber. This ain't a vacation spot, so go clean your glocks. So many names with spray cans, we can paint the blocks. I dreamed up, I never chill with no cream puff. Hanky sporty gear, the bottoms of a Sankey jeans cuff. I keep the power to speak, I ain't a flower for freaks. My dirt's deep, I ain't even go without a shower for weeks. So back a forfeit, your fags had a forfeit. I wet so many heads, they call my crew Farrah Fawcett. Sprinkle over here, there, whenever I feel. I'm no beginner or winner, but my deal will keep it real.
Shout outs to Milkbone. Album was dope. People sleep on him. People sleep on him. He had Nas in the video. Shout outs to the illest white rapper before Eminem made him disappear. Look. Kyle, usually this is the point where I ask you to tell people how to find you, but they know how to find you, and we're going to do more podcasts, so fuck all that. Listen. This is round one of 95 versus 96. We're very interested in hearing how you're going to score it, what you think. Put your personal opinions in there. Give us a personal opinion. Give us a non-objective. Give us, step out of yourself and just look at the facts and tell us. This guy really thinks that Reasonable Doubt's better than The Perfect Day.
And you all know this.
But give us some feedback. We'll put a post up. We'll put a poll up so we don't have to count tweets. But in the meantime, we're really going to leave this time and not when he was bringing up the other album. Thank you for listening. Thank you for downloading. Till next time, hip hop.
5,000.
Chill.
With the wig, it's the funk flex in your town with the get down. Giving you the best of 1995 right here on Hot 97.
Your life to be short, too, cause what you do, come to you.
fuck the glamour. So pop a squat, go drop the shot on your floor. And it don't matter in your plan, I got the tool. Drive about 45 to make your ass jump as I cruise up the block and let your system
I was the wino, what's yours is mine. Yo, I sneak up from behind slow. Before you think to make your move, that's when I break the rules and I'll snake your dudes. Give it to you how you want it, cause I'm running as I roll with my colo goalie. I'm ready to stick it because of the liquor that I drank. I don't think that's something that I really wanna do. So I bounce with my crew, kick it with my crew for a few boys in blue on the pad. Trying to harass, but I got my mind on some cash.
Hot 97 Street Jam. No dick with the wig, it's the funk flex. In your town, we can get there. Giving you the best of 1995 right here on Hot 97. Funk Master Flex giving you the best joints in 1995, bringing in 96 kind of strong. Act like you know how we do. Call us up 1-800-223-9797. It's the Hot 97 kind of charge tonight. Sean fire tonight. I want to play the water dance, but that didn't come out in 95. Darn it. Darn it. All right. Yeah, man.
Yo, Flex.
What's up, sir?
I just want to say that the 9-5. Nah. I'm reaching, y'all. Big up to my girl Dawn in Jersey City. I'm gonna be at your house in a few.
Chill, B.
Whoa, okay. Whoa. Now, what's happening? To get my groove on.
Oh, guys. Easy. Yeah, you're out of control. You want to say, okay, baby.
All right, here we go.
Now we do big up the whole Flip Squad. Big up my man Big Cat, Frankie Cutlass, DJ Enough, Mr. C, Doo-Wop, DJ Riz, a lot happening, you know what I'm saying? Big up my man Bobby J, the whole Flip Squad banging for a hot minute, all right? And like I said before, don't forget, if you want a Funkmaster Flex mixtape, it's out there in the stores, all right? We definitely appreciate all the support we've been getting. Here I one time. I like this record a lot. Big shout out to King Just. I ain't never got a new single from him, man. Break us off, Mr. King Just. Hey, we're gonna bounce a commercial. We'll be right back. I guess Big Dog Style.
Big Dog Style. All
right, and fellas, you know that New Year's Eve is coming up. You know what I'm saying? That's a big alcohol time. First of all, let's be serious and say, please don't drink and drive. True. All right, and there's another thing that's very dangerous for you. Please don't party and buy drinks for women that you just met in a couple minutes. It could break your wallet. Right back. That's right, boy. You know what I'm saying? This Sunday, December 31st, New Year's Eve, 1995. It's a Mecca New Year's Eve bash. You know what I'm saying? And you heard it right. The tunnel's open for New Year's Eve with special sponsorship from Carl Canine. It's hip-hop heaven, ghetto style, big dog style, with the Funk Master Flex on the set in the main room, the Bounce Master Doo-Wop, Uptown's number one, in the newly opened Champagne Lounge. I am Big Cap giving you mic flavor. The first 500 ladies will receive a Carl Canine baby tee, a free glass of champagne off the hook, and the first 500 players in the door will receive a special Carl Canine New Year's t-shirt. Doors open 9 p.m. There's a buffet which is served from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. We're partying until 6 a.m. It's on, so come on down to the tunnel for New Year's Eve Big Dog Style. The tunnel's at 27th Street and 12th Ave, sponsored by Carl Canine and Stress Entertainment. You know how we do. It's the Funk Flex in your town on New Year's Eve.
Representing all the flavors of hip-hop.
We ain't never gonna stop.
WQHT New York.
The only station for the hip-hop nation.
Hot 97, wishing you a happy holiday.
Happy holiday.
From Hot 97.
Where hip-hop lives.
No dick with the wig, it's the Funk Flex in your town with the good down. Uh-huh. Give me the best of 1995 right here on Hot 97.
Excuse me as I kiss the sky. Sing a song of sixpence, the pocket full of rye. On the dime, so they culture. Stalk the dead body like a vulture. The Calgon, blacker than your blackest stallion. Hit your housing. Projects, I represent your shallin. Oh yes, apocalypse now, the gunpowder be going down, diggy, diggy, down, diggy, down, down.
While the planets and the stars and the moons collapse, when I raise my trigger finger, all your fuckers hit the deck. Cause ain't no need for that, hustlers and hardcore. Roar to the floor, roar like reservoir doors. The green-eyed bandit can't stand it. More foodie and loops than that, you can't stand it. Plus, the Bombazi got me wild.
Word up, this is the Funk Doctor Spit Out, aka Red Man.
Hey yo, this is Method Man, aka the Callion Stallion, aka Johnny Blaze, aka the Cow.
Word up, we ain't getting blazed up on the high tip. We chilling with my man, Funk Master Flitax, son.
Yeah, you don't stop.